Good morning and welcome to the 17th meeting in 2023 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. Agenda item one is the economic and fiscal forecasts for May 2023 and the medium-term financial strategy. The first item on our agenda is to take evidence from the Scottish Fiscal Commission on its forecasts and on the MTFS. I welcome to the meeting Professor Graham Roy, who is the Chair, Professor Francis Breeden, the Commissioner, one Commissioner, and John Ireland, the Chief Executive of the Scottish Fiscal Commission. So before we move to questions, I'm going to ask Professor Roy if he would like to make an opening statement.
Good morning, Convener, and good morning, Committee, and thanks once again for the opportunity to come along and speak with you this morning. And give you a few reflections on our report and some key insights, I think, that we take from the latest economic outlook. So on a positive note, we're now forecasting the economy will avoid a shallow technical recession that we predicted back in December, but the overall environment remains one of slow and fragile growth. Inflation has started to fall from its peak of around 11% and should still fall sharply this summer. However, inflation will continue to exceed the growth in nominal household disposable incomes, meaning that living standards are once again likely to fall in 2023-2024. Turning to our fiscal forecasts, the updates we made in May are largely incremental. Forecast revenue from Scottish income tax has been revised up because of higher employment and nominal earnings. By 2027-2028, the forecast revenue increases by £209 million. However, the offsetting adjustment to the block grant also rises, following similar revisions by the OBR to their income tax forecast for the rest of the UK. The end result is a small upwards movement in the net funding available to the Scottish Government. Now, we do continue to advise caution over the outlook for the income tax net position. From experience, we can see that revisions to the outlook are quite common. The underlying Scottish and UK income tax forecasts are very large in terms of the overall magnitude, so the net tax position is driven by very small differences between the two. As in December 2022, a divergence in earnings growth between our and OBR's forecasts continues to be the main driver of the strong positive estimated income tax net position for Scotland, particularly toward the end of the forecast horizon. And crucially, and we advise that if the Scottish and UK earnings growth turn out to be closer in the coming years, then that next net tax position is likely to be materially lower than currently estimated. As we've highlighted in recent forecasts, we still expect a large and negative income tax reconciliation for the budget year 2021-2022. Comparing our and OBR's latest forecasts indicates a reconciliation of minus £712 million. Now, some uncertainty remains over the exact value, and final outturn data will be available in July 2023. On Social Security, we've also revised up our forecasts, mainly because of demand for disability benefits being higher than expected. We also estimate that by 2027-2028, total spending on Social Security payments will be £1.3 billion, more than the funding received from the UK Government through the associated block grant adjustments. And it's important to know that one of the main drivers for this is the Scottish Child Payment, with forecast spending of £436 million in 2027-2028. In December, I did caution that pressures from rising costs would mean that the funding position for individual government portfolios would be challenging, and that assessment remains unchanged despite our marginally more optimistic forecasts. One crucial point we can maybe touch on in the questions is that impact of inflation on the government's borrowing powers. So the borrowing limits set under the fiscal framework are fixed in cash terms and haven't changed since 2016. And we estimate that the financial power of borrowing has been eroded by almost 20% from the effects of inflation over that time. And then finally, Convener, if I could draw your attention to the consultation paper on baselines that we published alongside our forecasts. And this might appear to be a dry technical issue, but it's important about the assumptions we make about Scottish Government policy over the 5 years of our forecasts in the absence of a steer clear from Government. And we're speaking to a number of organisations over the summer to discuss these points. We welcome your views too.
Thank you very much, Professor Roy. And I think we'll probably all have a number of questions. So we're going to start with myself. I think we've got about 13 minutes each or thereabouts for committee members. So, you mentioned there the fact that your forecasts and the OBRs are somewhat different from each other, and you also say that there's more uncertainty than usual at this particular time. So Why is there more uncertainty at this time, and why this difference between the divergence, especially in earnings growth, between yourselves and the OBR?
So a couple of things I could say. So clearly we've mentioned several times, I think all the times I've come to this committee, just the challenges that exist in the global economy just now. We're coming in the back of a pandemic, cost of living crisis, and the exact time path for the economy remains uncertain. There's some risks on the upside. So we've seen, for example, an early lifting of COVID restrictions in China, which has helped expand the global economy. But clearly we've got effects of inflation still continuing to lag around, which are acting on the downside. We have to make judgment calls about that, but clearly the world is uncertain at the moment until the true effects of that feeding through to the overall budget. And so that's the point about uncertainty. On earnings growth and employment growth, so they're the key drivers of what the outlook will be for income tax in Scotland and the UK. And as you know, under the fiscal framework, what really matters for the net tax position is that relative performance, that relative difference between the outlook for Scottish income tax and the growth in rest of UK income tax. So that consequently means that what really then matters is the outlook for employment growth and the outlook for earnings growth in Scotland and the UK. And what we've seen over the last few years is a divergence there in between Scotland and the rest of the UK on earnings and on participation. And our judgment is that that gap will close over the immediate term horizon, and we can maybe go into some of the details about why we think that is the case. But even then, there's a judgment call that we make about earnings and a judgment call that the OBR make about earnings more broadly. And it happens to be the case that we are probably slightly more optimistic about earnings growth than the OBR are. And that gets back to the point about one of an important issue for the divergence. So we're forecasting, I think if you turn to page 53 and 54 of our report, where we have our forecast for earnings and there'll be our forecast for earnings. So we are forecasting around about, I think it's 2.6% growth in earnings over the outlook of our forecast. The OBR are forecasting nominal earnings growth of just 2%. Now, that's very low by historical standards. If they revise that up to be more in line with ours and they change that, or we revise down because we are too optimistic, then that means that those dynamics, the drivers of income tax, will converge much more, and that's why the net tax position could decline toward the end.
Because, I mean, traditionally we have found it hard to match the southeast of England and London, and their earnings have tended to be higher. So it's surprising to me that, you know, we've got this the other way around in a sense, yeah, this time.
So the story is rather similar to what we went through in the last report, is that there are a couple of sort of pro-Scottish factors going on at the moment, one of which is what's going on in the North Sea, that what we've seen for quite a long time now is the North Sea has been a drag because it's been a high-earning sector that's been sort of gradually diminishing. And actually what we're seeing, what we're expecting, and indeed what the data has been to show, is that actually the North Sea is not a positive, but it's no longer a drag. It's basically keeping up. So that sort of earnings effect is slightly reduced. The other thing that's positive for the Scotland is that rising interest rates tend to have a smaller effect in Scotland because the average Scottish person is less indebted than the average person in England. So that's the second factor. And the third one is that what we saw, a very, very strong finance sector, particularly in London last year, which really is a sort of bonus-related effect, which is beginning to unwind already, so that the finance sector is not, and London is not outperforming the finance sector in Scotland by as much as it did last year. So you're right. I think that all of those factors together won't make Scotland's earning growth match that in London and the South East, but what it will do is make it match that is in England as a whole, and that's what we're sort of basing the forecast on, or slightly go above England as a whole.
Okay, thank you. I mean, the big figure which you mentioned, which has obviously been in the media and so on, is the negative income tax reconciliation of something like £712 million. Mm-hmm. So firstly, how certain are we about that? Because I seem to remember in the past that even late on, the forecasts with the actual outturn were quite different from each other.
Yep.
So is there a possibility that We're just going to have to wait, and is it July, I think, we're getting the final figures, that they could be very different from 712 million.
So you will know in July the exact number which comes through. I think this time it's different, though. So clearly the forecasts, the forecasts will, you know, are an estimate, and we'll get the exact number, and we can have the outturn data and compare them there. But if you recall, the reason for this 700 million difference was back to during the COVID times and the timing of the different forecasts. And if you recall, when the OBR assessment was made, which formed the BGA, that was done at quite a different point in the pandemic. It was at the time of where the Omicron virus variant was spreading around, and the outlook for the economy across the UK was much more pessimistic. By the time the Fiscal Commission and the Scottish Budget did their forecast, later in the budget process, but earlier in the year, the outlook was much more positive. And it's a difference in timing and a difference of the assessments of the outlook. And if you recall back then, the point was made, look, actually there's a timing issue here, and that's likely to mean that the BGA number will be revised up significantly, and that will be a key driver of the reconciliation. So in the past, the forecasts have changed because outturn data has differed, and that's just the nature of forecasting. This is more a fundamental question about actually when the judgments were made around the BGA and the tax position, and that's why the number is so big and large this time. So in that context, you know, will it be 700 million? Will it be 650 million? 600 million? I mean, we'll know in July, but I guess the key point is that we can be pretty confident that that will be a very large negative reconciliation because of the nature of the issue that's driving it.
Yeah, just and also to add the point that we had a few times, which is even though it could get revised to be an even bigger number. I mean, you know, at this point, we don't know which way the revision will go. It could be an even bigger reconciliation, or be slightly smaller, it's equal probability as far as we're concerned. Therefore, I think it's not a situation where you should ignore it just because the final number might be slightly different. Because I think this is giving, as Graham says, this is giving you a very strong steer that there is a big negative number coming, and even though the final number might be a bit different from the number we say, it could be bigger than in practice.
Okay, Mr. Ireland, if you want to come in at any point, just jump in, and that's fine. Thank you. I mean, your own forecast in December was, compared to now, is that tax receipts were 384 million less than that you're now forecasting. Can you explain quite why that was, why it's changed so much since December?
In terms of the uplift in forecasts?
Yes.
So there are several things. So we've got data. So what happens is we get new data all the time coming through, and we've got new data on earnings across the UK. And actually what we see is that earnings data and income receipts that we're tracking are higher across the UK. And that's an uplift relative to where it was. We also get things like public sector pay awards feeding through, which again are higher than forecast in December. We've seen a much greater resilience, in earnings as across the economy as a whole, which have all led to an uplift in our forecast for tax revenues. And also that judgment we make about the slightly more optimistic outlook in the near term for the economy has again helped boost the revenues. Interesting, we haven't actually changed our assessment of the economic outlook by the end of the forecast period. It's just that we think it's, rather than entering a technical shallow recession, the outlook will be relatively flat, but essentially we'll have the same outcome at the end of the five-year forecast period. Again, one thing I should say is that 300 million sounds a lot, but when we're dealing in the magnitudes of revenues that we're talking about of thousands of millions, then actually 300 million is a relatively small change in the forecast overall.
Yeah, the problem is our borrowing limits are only 300 million, so we'll raise that with the Deputy First Minister next week. You mentioned data in there, and I just how are you finding it now for getting the data you need on the time you need it? Because I know in the past that was a problem.
Yeah, I appreciate you asking about that. So, we continue to work really closely with the key agencies that provide the data to us. I think mentioned last summer when we provided our statement of data needs that we had made good progress with the government, particularly on economy data and particularly on tax data. you wouldn't be surprised to say we could always do with some more data and we'd always like some more information. Some of that is some of the challenges we have is just the limitations of the devolved context and the relatively small size of the Scottish economy in that perspective as well. I think the big progress we've made is, and it's still early days, is around Social Security. So I think that was our big concern back in the summer. And we've been working really closely with Social Security Scotland to get the information for them to collect the data in a way that's helpful and also to have a really constructive relationship where we can essentially get their intelligence about what they're picking up as they're rolling out these benefits and new payments. So there's still more work to do there, but I think we're relatively comfortable where we are in terms of accessing the data.
OK, and then the final question from myself. You say that in future years you do not currently anticipate any negative reconciliations or forecast errors after 24-25. Can you just say why you think that's the case?
So again, it comes back to Francis' point about what's the balance of it. So there will be reconciliations. I can guarantee you that. But I guess what we're saying is at this moment in time, we don't see that there's a necessary you know, case that is definitely going to be a positive or negative reconciliation in that way. As I said, that brings us back to the 700 million figure. That was quite a different reason than just forecast error. This was the timing of when the forecasts were made and cautioned very much at the time, saying that the difference, particularly in the BGA that was embedded into the budget, was a significant underestimate of the actual reality. And that's why we're pretty confident that the negative reconciliation that's coming will be large.
So in some ways that was a one-off because of COVID and it was also turbulent.
Yeah, and I think the reason for that, I think, was quite different. There is an interesting question about, that can happen again. And this comes back into the overall questions about how the fiscal framework operates. And having negative or positive reconciliations driven by when budget statements are made doesn't, it poses challenges to. I don't think anyone would say that's a good situation to be into, where you're having to make financial decisions based upon timings of announcements. But we will always have reconciliations. That's the nature of the framework. And these reconciliations could be large, because coming back to that point, you're dealing with thousands of millions of income tax revenues that are moving around. So reconciliations and changes in the forecast of hundreds of millions of pounds are entirely possible, which comes back to your point about flexibilities in the fiscal framework to manage that.
Okay,
it's worth adding that although the 700 is sort of a bit of a one-off because of the situation surrounding that, we're in a situation where, the reconciliation is the difference between two very large numbers, and both the numbers are getting bigger very quickly because of inflation. So we actually anticipate that in future reconciliations will get big, will tend to be bigger than they have been. So although 700 was due to special circumstances, we're actually saying that a 700 of plus or minus is not something to be surprised of in the future.
Okay, thanks very much, Ed. So Douglas Lumsden's next.
Camilla, just want to go back to the earnings growth. Obviously, the OBR figures are 2.0 and your own figures of 2.6 for Scotland. You hinted that there might be some factors behind that you can maybe sort of expand on. So can you maybe do that, Professor Roy?
A couple of things, if it's OK. I mentioned page 54 in our report, which talks about that. There's an interesting chart at the bottom there, which shows the relative difference, the relative comparison of Scottish earnings versus UK earnings and the long-run average there. And what we've seen over the last 5 years or so is a gap widening between Scottish earnings and UK earnings. And we think that part of that is the situation in the North East and the high-value jobs in there, and that's been acting to pull down Scottish earnings relative to the UK. Our assessment is that's not going, at least in the short term, we don't see that continuing. So the data we track shows that Aberdeen is at least not diverging, the North East is not diverging in the same way as it has done from the rest of Scotland. And that means that divergence isn't going to continue. We think there'll be a relative catch-up to some extent in the short term. There's longer-term questions about the outlook there that is important. And Francis was saying there again about we've seen very high growth in financial services in London. which again changes the average and then drags the UK away from Scotland. So that's some issues where we think, at least in the divergence, it's perhaps not going to continue to this in the same detriment to Scotland over the next 2 to 3 years. There's a broader question, though, is about what is the judgment as economists looking across the economy that we what we think might happen to earnings. And our judgment is that we think that earnings will grow in Scotland around about 2.6%. The OBR making a completely independent, different assessment, think it's going to be lower than that. Who's right? We'll obviously have to wait and see. But if they become more like us or we become more like them, then the net income tax position won't be as strong because essentially what we're doing is assuming higher earnings growth than the rest of the UK and that will boost our revenues.
So I guess it's not so much divergence, but we're actually, you're predicting we're coming closer again because, you know, 0.6 probably doesn't sound too much of a big number. But I guess what would that do if they did come together? But, you know, if OBR revised their figures back up to 2.6 growth, what would that do to our tax income going forward?
So,
to the BGRs?
So the earnings piece is crucial to the income tax element. I can't remember, John, we do have a rule of thumb number we talk about. I'm not going to say it because I'll probably have to write to correct it. But we can give you the number there. But it's really, you know, so like a 1% swing in earnings is magnitude of hundreds of millions of pounds. We'll get the exact number for you, but it's really crucial to that relative differential in earnings. And that's where you see that if you look at what's been happening to the net tax position, shifting to from negative to positive, is driven partly by policy, but crucially by what's happening to the earnings outlook. Mm-hmm.
So how much caution should the Scottish Government use on this figures just now? When they look at the OBR figures, you know, obviously the average growth in earnings over the last 11 years has been 2.7%, and now they've switched it down to 2%. So how much caution should the Scottish Government give to this figure?
Yeah, so we explicitly say in the report that particularly toward the end of the forecast period that caution should be used in that. I mean, I think we would hope that Scottish earnings growth would outperform the rest of the UK, and these will come through to tax revenues. But as I said, one of the crucial differences is our judgment relative to the OBRs is more optimistic for the outlook for earnings than theirs. And if that doesn't turn out to be true, so if we converge, then that net tax position will ease back down. So that's the caution that we would advise.
And when's the next milestone? When does the OBR publish the next estimates?
So they'll be in the autumn to support the UK budget, and we'll be doing the same around ours. So it's definitely something to watch, and I think when we come back to when you'll see that movement in the net tax position, and that'll be when we'll know more.
Mm-hmm. And I can just give you that sensitivity that we sort of ran some estimates, as Graham was saying. We estimated a 0.1% extra growth in Scottish average nominal earnings relative to the rest of the UK leads to a 25 million increase in the net position. And that's on page 61 of the report.
Okay.
So 1% would be 250 million, 0.6 would be 100 million. So it's a significant number, and it builds over time.
Yeah, but for the last 5 years, we've been lagging behind earnings for the rest of the UK.
Yeah, and you see that, again in the net income tax position chart, where government are trying to seek to raise revenues through changes in the tax, well, freezing the tax bands and increasing tax rates relative to the rest of the UK, but the actual amount of tax take coming in hasn't been keeping up with what you might have expected to raise, and the reason is because earnings haven't been growing as quickly as the rest of the UK, also some issues around participation, and that means that the net tax position is perhaps not as good as you'd hoped it would be because tax base isn't as growing as quickly as you'd like.
Okay. Moving on to a next question, if I may. In terms of, obviously, the estimates you've been making of the government spending, what assumptions have you made around the public sector workforce? Have you seen that number falling or staying constant?
In terms of our forecasts, what we tend to do in terms of the spending outlook is that we look at the essentially the overall funding envelope. So what we look at is things like the block grant outlook for tax revenues, etc. So we don't really get into the details in terms of the specifics of the policy choices, which would include outlook for things like employment and choices within that. So we're looking at the overall funding envelope, and that's driving that. In terms of when we had in December our forecasts for public sector employment and pay, can you remember that, John?
You're not back to December, but each forecast, because we need to think about public sector employment and public sector earnings, we have a mechanical rule which operates. And that rule basically shows at the moment in the May forecast, we're expecting the public sector workforce to fall by about 1%. So, but that involves both the UK government's employment in Scotland, the Scottish government's employment, and the wider Scottish public sector, including local authorities, with local authorities being a very big driver. I suppose the contrast really is in terms of what the government has put into its MTFS, where they have a couple of scenarios which have got positive growth for public sector employment. But just to stress again that ours just works off in a very mechanical way of public expenditure, sort of the likely pay pressures that the government talks about, and that just gives us a number for public sector employment.
So looking forward, you don't have any estimates on the size of the public sector workforce?
We basically say that it's falling very gently by, I think, about 1% over the next year, and that sort of trend continues, okay, which is... So which is in contrast...
1% per year, that's what I was trying to...
Yeah. Okay. An annual fall of that.
It is worth, to John's point, which is it is very sort of mechanical, just runs off the funding envelope. You know, it's, we're not forecasting it in a sort of, you know, in anger. It's just something that falls out from the process sort of thing. So.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Last question was around social security spend. We've seen that go from, I think, about £3.6 billion in 21-22. It's going to be rising to... Well, it's going to be doubling... by 27-28. Mm-hmm. So behind that, I guess there's two things. Inflation is obviously pushing the welfare bill up, but also I guess there is new welfare commitments that's not matched, that doesn't come through in the block grant adjustments. So how much is it on each of those? Mm-hmm. And you know, if we never had these new commitments, what would the social security bill be going forward?
So you're right, there's probably three big drivers going on to that. So first of all is inflation, with most of the key benefits uprated by CPI at key points. Then a lot of the big increase we're seeing in social security is coming through inflation. And we made that point in December, and that's one of the big drivers to it. The secondly is the increasing evidence across the UK about demand for key social security payments, particularly around disability payments and adult disability payments. You might come on to that post-COVID and some of the evidence that is being picked up around effects of long COVID and waiting times, etc. And that's driving it. Now, of course, in the Scottish context, both of these at the margin are lead to higher spending but also higher funding. So that's not a risk in that sense to the Scottish budget, because it comes through the block grant adjustment. Where the difference comes through is where either the Scottish Government is introducing new social security payments or where they're changing the benefit system that's being allocated, which leads to higher spending relative to the BGAs. And page 82 of our report, figure 5.6, talks about those differences there. And we think that difference between the amount of funding flowing through for social security payments and actually what the government are committing to spend is 1.3 billion by the end of the forecast period, and that's money that has to be found either from taxation or from other sources in the budget.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks very much. So Michael Marra is next.
Thanks, Convener.
Can I return to workforce, if that's okay? The resource spending review said that the government was going to seek to return the size of the public sector workforce to pre-COVID levels. Mm-hmm. And what you're saying is you've not baked in any of those figures in terms of policy intent into your forecasts. Is that correct?
Yes. Yeah. We haven't put anything specific this time into changes in is changes employment forecasts. It's purely mechanical in that context.
It would be a major impact on the public finances if we were to take that trajectory that was the previous statement. I suppose we had the Permanent Secretary in front of us a few weeks ago who stated that they were working on the assumption, or he was operating on the assumption, that that was the direction of travel, but that the government had made no new government under the new First Minister had made no specific statement. If there was a specific statement, would you be modelling that into your figures?
Yeah, so we model specific policies on government employment or and pay when we have the evidence to do it. I think, again, coming back to the answer to Douglas, I think you've got to remember what part of the fiscal process we do. So, for example, we would the way it would come through to us would be is potentially changing our employment forecast. If we think that the government are changing employment levels, potentially income tax forecast, that's the way it would come through. We would then think about how that might impact on funding. But when it comes to the spending bit, what we're essentially doing is looking at what's the overall envelope that the government will have, what they then choose to do that with, you know, allocating it either to public sector wages or employment or spending on day-to-day services. That's not an area that we would typically go into because we were just looking at the overall totality of the budget. So, but in short, we would factor in, if the government came with an explicit policy of doing something, then we would take it as a policy that would enter our modelling process.
Okay, that's useful. The government also in the medium-term financial strategy has is seeking to establish an external tax stakeholder group. What do you think the job of that body is? What does it have to do?
It's an interesting question. It strays out our remit because obviously what we won't comment on policy per se, and it's up to the government to come forward with that. I mean, some general reflections, I think, on what I would say about the overall reflections on tax and the debate here. And I would say that the most important thing to look at is our long-term work that we've done on the outlook for the budget. And we were here a couple of months ago talking about that. And for me, that's really important work to look at. What are the long-term structural challenges coming down the line for our public services in terms of the rising costs in health, the demand and demographics, et cetera. And I think there is a really important debate, not just in Scotland, but more broadly across the UK and internationally, about what does the public finance system look like for public services that are going to be much higher demand and going to cost a lot more in the future. And that's where you start to get into some really interesting debates about tax. So for me, I think one of the things I'm really interested to see from that group is what is the long-term, what's the long-term evidence about the future of tax in the context of the changing nature of our public services.
And are you doing much work on that then in terms of, so for instance, modelling on behavioural effects at longer term, given where we are with the tax situation, the divergence within the UK?
So our remit is quite explicit that what we can do is model the specific policy choices of the government. So hypotheticals, then we wouldn't be able to do that. That'd have to be done somewhere outside of the Fiscal Commission. We do work all the time on things like tax modelling and behavioural forecasts, etc., to inform the process. And I would hope that our work might inform the thinking that might go on in a body like that. But if they come out with ideas and suggestions, etc., that wouldn't be for us to do. And that's just the nature of our framework that we operate
on. Of course, but you are doing that. Are you doing any of that preemptive work then in terms of...
No, exactly. I think that's been a big part of our sort of research agenda since we've begun, really, to say, because it clearly... the tax situation is, well, not unique, but it's unusual in the sense that obviously the border between England and Scotland is extremely permeable, and therefore that has implications for behavioural impacts of tax. And that's something we done quite a lot of work on. We had an international conference because, as I said, it's not, even though it's unusual for the UK, it's a very common across the world. There are lots of countries with income tax differences across regions. And we have a body of work to look more and more in the Scottish case. But you know, as a sort of research economist, you'd say Scotland is still very, you know, as is often the case with economics, it's still too early to say. You know, it's the policy divergence between Scotland and England is still quite new, and therefore I think the international evidence actually will continue to be a really important guide to the Scottish experience. We'll do more and more work on the particular experience of Scotland, but as I say, at the moment, international evidence is very helpful because there are countries with a long-standing period of different tax rates between regions.
And what does that evidence tell you?
Roughly, that there is an impact, but it isn't enormous in the sense that you're still in a situation where if you raise particularly the higher rates, if you raise taxes, you still get revenue. It isn't the case that the behavioural impacts offset that, and that's one extreme example of that is in the United States, where some states have a millionaire's tax, and there was a very strong view that that millionaire's tax would just result in millionaires migrating from one state to another. But what the evidence shows actually most of the millionaires stayed put, and therefore it did actually generate overall revenue in the United States. And so they say that's right up at the millionaire's end, so you can see that there is a positive impact from these things. But of course, what it does mean is you don't raise very much revenue from raising higher rates, but you still raise some.
OK. And just conclude, how urgent is the work of the tax group, given the situation that we're facing and what's outlined in your forecasts?
Yeah. So I think, and we had it in the conversation about the long-term financial outlook. My personal view is that I think it is really urgent that we have the conversation about the long-term future trajectory of the public finances in Scotland. And this is not a unique challenge to Scotland. It's common across high-income economies. But these pressures are here and now, and you see that through the demand on public services. And they're only going to accelerate over the years to come. So I think having a conversation about tax, having a conversation about public services and reform and how we grow our economy are really crucial, because big fundamental structural decisions are going to have to be made about how we can continue to protect public services over the long term that we all value. So I think it is urgent. I would caution against quick solutions, and here's a simple thing that if you do this one thing, it's going to be easy. I think it's going to have to be a long process, but I don't think it should be, you can make decisions now and you can start putting in place the work that you need to do in order to change.
Okay. That's good. Okay. Liz Smith is next.
Thank you. Good morning. I've got two areas of questioning. The first is about the frustration that I think we all feel when it comes to the different timings of the forecasts that underpin, whether it's a medium-term financial strategy or any other set of forecasts, and how the OBR and the SFC forecasts relate to the sort of different timings of the budget cycle. And that obviously has an impact on the projections that can be made given the data of that time. Do you think that there is scope to try to bring these forecasts, the timing of these forecasts, slightly closer together so that it makes it easier? I'm sure the OBR and the SFC would welcome that as well.
I think in terms of, in a principal point of view, I think it does make sense to have the forecasts from a purely technical point of view as being as close as possible, so we end up in situations like we had back in the COVID period, where you've got a very fast-moving economic environment, which then means that any delay between that means that the economic environment you're looking at looks quite different there. So in principle, yes, I do appreciate that our forecasting is one part of a big budget process that takes place in Scotland and takes place in the UK, and both parliaments need to proper time to scrutinise and do that. And I think it'd be, clearly, it's really important that they're together. But it does avoid things like the reconciliations that we've got just now, where a large part of that is simply through the timing of the publications. Mm. And that can't be a good outcome. So there might be ways you can get around that. So obviously things like, I think back then the government were offered a different BGA or a revised BGA at that point. So could you actually potentially do something different, that even if you've got a delay there, where there's a material difference in circumstances, could you think about, changing the nature of the framework to be more flexible, so you've got maybe more accurate assessment from both? These are certain things which I think are definitely worth discussing as part of the review.
And just in the discussions about the forthcoming new fiscal framework to replace the 2016 one, are you aware of any discussions about this forecasting element?
So we're not part of these discussions, so I wouldn't know that. I mean, we've been quite clear on the record about that's one of the things that we think should be looked at and could be looked at, but yeah, I wouldn't know where the review was on that.
Right. Okay. Thank you. That's helpful. And secondly, there's obviously a very big question to be asked about both the medium term and the longer term planning ahead for the economy. And you cited this in response to Michael Marrow just now. The gap between Scottish Government projected expenditure and the tax take is obviously a very serious issue, and that brings our attention as a committee to two things. What scope is there for serious public sector reform that could help address this problem? And secondly, how can we increase the tax take? Could I just ask about the first of these, namely public sector reform? Do you have any suggestions to make about the most likely areas of public sector reform that could help, given that in health, in social security, and in social care, there is almost certainly no scope for any reduction in spending? These are going to increase very substantially. In fact, I think your own estimates have already shown that. What scope is there for public sector reform that really could help that side of the equation?
Mm-hmm. So, unfortunately, I think getting into specifics about what government could do probably, you know, strays out our remit in terms of suggesting policies in that. The general point that you make, though, if I can make some comments, I think is really important, and I think this gets back to our long-term fiscal sustainability work, where we were projecting that health will start to take, you know, get up to the point where it takes over half the entire budget, and coming through demographics, rising costs in there. So that's clearly one part of the budget that has to be looked at about, well, how can you continue to deliver the high quality healthcare in a situation where the costs of delivery and demand for that are going to get up? And from a purely economics point of view, I guess the key thing is how can you essentially reduce lifetime expenditure per head on issues like health? And that's not to say cut people's expenditure on health, but it's about getting into things like prevention. So tackling inequality, growing the economy, so that you can actually, when the demand that people are using in the health service is actually be able to be reduced, so you're not doing so much corrective activity you've done there. And that's not just unique to Scotland, that's what lots of countries are looking at. There's obviously what can you do to actually become more efficient at delivery. So I heard a fascinating talk yesterday from Geeta Gopinath, who's the number two in IMF, talking about AI, artificial intelligence, how you can use artificial intelligence in terms of detecting, you know, cancers in people, about detecting illnesses, about using that to deliver certain types of treatments, etc. So how can you use new technologies to deliver public services again, so you can reduce the cost on delivering these services in there? So in many ways, this gets back to Christie. It gets back to the stuff that this committee's discussed repeatedly about the need for reforms there. So you're not changing the quality, but you're reducing essentially the cost that is having to be paid in order to deliver that quality service. And that's the areas that I think we need to focus on.
Thank you. And you're quite right. You can't make comment on projected policies that the Scottish Government should employ. I'm just interested in whether, as you bring together a lot of the analysis that you do and the data that you're using, whether you're aware of other countries and other attempts to try to reform public services in a way that you've just said about increasing efficiency or making use of technology or whatever. And you've given us three or four examples in that answer just now. Are there other areas that you think we should be looking at without projecting into Scottish Government policy?
Yeah. And so again, and going back to our long-term report, the areas we talk about are saying that there's a number of different things that are driving what the outlook for the public finances. So one is obviously on the spending side. So what can you do to essentially maintain the quality but adjust the spending profile? Second, what can you do in the economy? So what can you do to essentially raise the tax take in in Scotland, again, crucially in this framework, relative to the UK? So what can we do to outperform the UK, to bring the revenues in there? And then what can you do around migration? So what can you do about attracting more people to come to Scotland? Either that being taking a bigger share of international migration coming into the UK, or attracting our UK people to Scotland, and again, crucially, to come in to create high value, to work in high value jobs that pay the tax revenues, because the nature again of this framework means that it's income tax revenues, particularly amongst higher earners, that really matters. Mm. And that's the different areas which I think are worth looking at.
Mm. Okay, my second aspect of this is about tax revenues, just as you've said, and obviously that there are ways at which you can increase tax revenues by changing tax rates and thresholds, etc. But there is this question about the change to tax structures. And there's a debate going on down south just now about whether inheritance tax should be replaced, etc. And we've had lots of debates up here about whether council tax should change, etc. Again, going back to the analysis that you're aware of in other countries which have changed their tax structures, do you feel that that is a debate that is urgent here in terms of trying to address some of the concerns that we have about a weakening tax return?
Mm. A couple of things, and maybe we'd get Francis's thoughts as well. The first point to make is a really important debate globally about the future of tax and the nature of the tax system and what we tax. And increasingly, if you're moving to a world where there's increasing value of capital in the economy, so an increasing value of companies making profits through automation, through AI, and less worker input, then how are you taxing that? So that essentially, if you're squeezing the amount of labour in the economy, how are you taxing capital efficiently in order to pay for the public services? And I think that's a really important global tax debate that's going on, and that's clearly getting into things like wealth taxes. Mm-hmm. Getting into corporate taxes, all of those sorts of things. And clearly in Scotland, we have a relatively narrow tax base in terms of its income tax and property taxes, and that's essentially it. So you don't have that broader spectrum in there. So any conversation that is happening about these broader taxes, then that has an impact about what you might want to do in the future around devolution of taxes and the like. I think in terms of the Scottish context, again, the nature of income tax means that what's so important is the growth in high earnings, and what do you do around that, and that's where you broaden out. So less about it's about the volume of high taxpayers that you have, which really matters. And again, that's not a political comment, it's just an arithmetic comment about that's the way income tax works there. And then the broader point is that the more you can grow that is crucial to creating the underlying revenues that will grow income tax. So the base is absolutely crucial and fundamental in there. So, you know, again, the government, they do some really helpful ready reckoners around income tax. So, you know, increasing the higher rate, you know, 1 pence, £88 million. Again, we're talking about the numbers there. We're talking about earnings, you know, 0.1 change in earnings, 25 million. So you can see that very small changes in the performance of your economy can have a really quite significant impact on your overall earnings base. And that's why broadening out that tax base is really important.
And just to finish off on that point, when you had your breakfast in the Parliament some weeks ago, I think we focused on the sort of high growth, potential growth areas of financial services, of renewables, of digital industries, technology. Are there other areas of the workforce where you think we've got more chance of widening that tax base and better, higher paid jobs?
Mm-hmm. So you're right. The nature of the economy is that you have sectors that are naturally going to be more productive than others, and therefore sectors that are naturally high earning relative to others. So from an economic policy point of view, you can do one of two things. One is you can try and grow these high-performing sectors in your economy relative to elsewhere, and that's why things like financial services, energy, you mentioned renewables, etc., are all really important because they are naturally highly productive sectors, which will then generate the broad tax base that you want. That's not to say you shouldn't also think about what can we do to boost productivity in the other sectors in the economy, so things like hospitality, things like care, public services, etc., because if you can make them more productive, then they will actually improve their earnings as well. So it's riding the two horses there. So one is about attracting and growing the high productive sectors, and the other part is how you can actually make other sectors in the economy more productive.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks very much, Liz. And it's Michelle is next.
Good morning. I think that leads quite neatly a bit onto the area I wanted to ask about in terms of capital expenditure. I mean, we know that the block grant funding from the UK government is the largest component of the Scottish government's capital funding. And your projection suggests that it's going to be cut in nominal terms by 14% between 2023-24 to 2028-2029. So my question is, how will this cut, in your view, affect the productive capacity of the Scottish economy? In what ways?
Yeah, so you're right. On page, I think it's page 18 of the report, we talk about the outlook for capital spending. So just to, it's a 14% cut in real terms that we've got there. And you're right, it's the block grant that's driving that. In terms of our forecasts for what we think about is happening in the economy, broadly speaking, the way that we capture changes in capital spending in the economic outlook is largely just an arithmetic exercise. It's just a change in spend. So we don't capture in our short term, in our medium term, in our 5-year forecast, we don't capture the change in productive capacity from that. We don't alter. It's just money in, money out, and reduction in that. But you're right. The broader question is what's the long term benefits of the capital expenditure that you're coming from that. We've not made an assessment of that, not in this report, because I said it's just an accounting exercise that we have in terms of the money coming in and out. But clearly, cuts to capital expenditure have an impact on the long-term productivity.
So if we can explore that a bit more, perhaps then if you could, all of you as top-notch economists, just help, and perhaps for the record, how productive capacity can be affected by low levels of capital expenditure. And I'm thinking things around, you've talked about AI, R&D, productivity itself, economic growth, sustainable well-being or otherwise. Can you just give a flavour of the real impact of whatever figure, whether it's a 14% cut that we know in real terms or otherwise? Because I think that would be useful for the record.
So, broadly, how capital expenditure can impact on the economy. Essentially, it means that you can produce more output for the same amount of effort, broadly speaking. So things like transport infrastructure gets you from A to B quicker. That makes you can do more for the same amount of effort that's going in there. So particularly things around transport infrastructure have a direct impact on productivity. Things like education infrastructure, they're much longer term and real benefits over the medium term there. So if you can improve the quality of schooling, you can improve the quality of physical infrastructure around that, then the benefits for that will be marginal, but will build up over time into that. There are obviously some parts of capital expenditure that might have less of an impact that government might do that on productivity. So if it's a particular government building, or if it's a prison or something like that, then we naturally wouldn't maybe capture that in terms of productivity there. But it's crucially about how can you actually just change the productive capacity largely by improving the way the economy operates. And historically, that's where one of the things the UK has lagged behind as a whole, key competitors. And that's one of the potentially long-term explanations for the productivity puzzle in the UK relative to other countries.
Actually, you've already prompted my next question. Do you have any, off the top of your head, I appreciate, comparative figures of how UK, say, perhaps in the last 10 years, capital investment compares with other states?
I don't think it's anything that we've looked at. Francis, do you want to think from comparison?
And also, I think... I mean, there's obviously a big difference between private sector and public sector investment here, which I'm trying to think. And it also obviously varies because there are countries with much bigger public sectors in to start with. So, yeah, so that's me just saying really no. I don't know the answer to that question.
But it's one of these, I mean, it's one of a number of factors that people have speculated about, you know, why the UK productivity has potentially lagged behind is a bit of a capital investment, particularly in connectivity, digital infrastructure. So again, you can compare digital infrastructure in the UK versus the best Scandinavian countries, and you can see the difference. And then you've got all the other explanations like management practice and the like that potentially explain the productivity piece as well. But capital investment is crucial in the long run for investment.
And so following on from that, you indicate that, you know, the Scottish Government may receive further funding from other sources than the block grant. What are they, and what do you see as the key risks for them not materialising? In other words, I'm trying to flesh out the extent to which they can be relied upon relative to the block grant, which we know has got this significant cut.
Yeah. So we talk about page 34, we talk about the different elements of the outlook for capital funding. The government, obviously, you mentioned, get the key chunk from the block grant. That's the most important element. They can obviously borrow as well. And we talk a bit in there about the constraints on borrowing and potentially hitting the limit. There's a really important point about the erosion, the effect of inflation, eroding the amount of limit, the amount of money the government can borrow, and the fact that they've been fixed in cash terms since 2016, and you've got high inflation, and the amount that the government can essentially add in to that is constrained. And in the other funding we talk about things like city deals, so potentially future city deals that might come down the line, which might lead to additional capital funding that would be outside the block grant. That's potentially a source of funding. Of course, that depends on policy choices at the UK. And then what the government might do with the Scotland Reserve as well. So money they're putting in there, moving from one year to the next. That's where potentially they can try and offset some of the potential negative outlook in the block grant.
I think your contention is correct that the block grant is, you know, dominates that. It's really, that's where the money really comes from.
Okay, and therefore any cut in that block grant has potentially significant impact. My last wee question then, just to finish off, it strikes me that because of the limitations instilled by a fixed budget, the narrative is continually about revenue spend, for very good reason. Of course, it needs to be scrutinised and monitored without the same necessarily awareness in a kind of body politic, if you like, of the implications of capital expenditure and investment terms. Is that something that, again, as economists, you see happening almost as an inevitable consequence? I can see your nodding.
I think it's a very common issue internationally. So that, you know, that you, when budgets are tight, capital spending looks like a very easy cut because it doesn't create as much immediate pain as cuts in other areas. But of course, it, as your questions are implying, it doesn't create immediate pain, but it has these long run consequences that you have to pick up later on. So I think that is sadly a common feature that's what governments tend to do in these sort of circumstances where money is tight. Capital seems like a good place to start.
And is it even more prevalent in Scotland because the tendency is to focus on revenue because of the fixed budget?
Possibly. I mean, I think the fact that you're raising capital, I think, is a really important point, and we need to think about, you know, what we do about the capital budget and the allocations there. Is it Scotland? I mean, I think I remember back to maybe 10 years ago when there was a big debate about capital investment, and it was all part of the government acceleration programme post the financial crisis, and there was a big debate and discussions around the value of capital investment and trying to accelerate that and shovel-ready projects and things. So I think there has been an understanding about the value of capital. I know the government do the infrastructure investment plan and set out how they expect the capital budget to feed through to these outcomes. But you're right, and I think again this comes back to the conversation with with Ms Smith there about the long term, what we're doing to prepare for these long term challenges. So you're right, productivity is one element, and that's where the capital budget is really crucial. But what are you investing in the public services through your capital budget to help you take advantage of the investments that you make now for offsetting some of the long term challenges caught down the line? So yeah, the more that you want from us in capital and understanding of that, the better. Happy to help.
Oh, well, good. Thank you.
I would say also that, I mean, a particular question about it being an issue in Scotland, I mean, in a sense, that your previous questions shows it isn't that much, because, in a sense, the block grant is so dominant in what the capital spending envelope is, that, in a sense, you know, Scotland is spending up to its envelope in capital, and it's the block grant that's driving that.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks, Michelle. Keith Brown's next.
Thanks very much, Chair. Good morning. Just to say that my questions might be a bit naive and all over the place. I'm a new member of the committee, but I was just interested in the point that about inflation leading to slightly lower expectations for inflation and interest rates in the near term. And just from what I observe, where core inflation has actually increased, I think, to 6.8%, and most commentators think that we're going to get at least one, probably two more interest rate increases, the effect it's already having on the housing market and the mortgage rates. How confident, or have you got a timescale for when you expect to see that reduction in inflation? I think we were told last year it was going to be the middle of this year when we see that reduction, but that's not happened.
So I'll go first and then Francis can come in. You're right. So what the big story in town is what's happening to inflation and the effects of that. And the first thing is that inflation will come down quickly over the next few months simply because of the way it's calculated. So it's looked at from one point in the year to the previous point last year. And because we had this spike, it will naturally come down. The key question and the key point that you're making, which is really crucial, is, you know, how quickly will it come down, but crucially, how embedded any expectations about inflation will be over the next year or so. And that's where the concern, the potential concern that's being raised with amongst people, is that it will come down quickly, but will it actually level off and be at a higher rate? And if that happens, then the Bank of England will have to be more aggressive at trying to increase interest rates in order to bring inflation down, and that's where it gets challenging for the economy, because essentially they face a really difficult trade-off between slowing the economy to try and combat inflation, but then not trying to tip the economy into a downturn. And that's, we just need to wait and see, and hope we get it right over the next few months.
It's sort of been a really odd combination, in the sense that the original culprit behind this inflation, energy, in a sense, has actually come down way faster than we were originally predicting. So without that, you would have thought we would see this inflation falling more. But in fact, what we've seen is that that burst of energy prices we got last year is still working its way through every single other price, food prices, everything, even though the actual energy price itself has fallen. So that's one of the many reasons why we think the fall is happening, because, for example, I mean, we're getting the price cap revised in July, and there'll be a big fall in energy bills, in July, and another one potentially in October. So we sort of know those negatives are coming. But as your question implies, that, you know, the core has been surprisingly resilient, given that we would have thought the core inflation would have come down faster than it has.
Yeah, I can't say I've seen any evidence in my own bills for a reduction in energy costs so far, to be honest. But and I suppose that's the important point. It's what people are actually having to spend that's going to have an impact on inflation. Just taking two or three things together, Michelle Thompson's questioning about capital, a 14% reduction over the next few years. I think it says somewhere in your report that living standards are taking one of the biggest hits and are projected to take one of the biggest hits that we've ever seen. And on the revenue side, it's a pretty small increase over the next few years. You've been asked a number of questions about comparative inflation to taxes. This, which could be described, and I'm not asking you to do it, as a kind of austerity period again going forward. Is there any comparison that's been done in relation to following this kind of austerity policies, which are odd given that national debt's ballooned to £2.5 trillion, but these austerity policies are working for the ends which were set out, or are other countries following a different path which is more productive? Is there any comparative studies which have been done on that?
So it's not something we've looked at to compare in to that context to what everyone else is doing. I think the general comment I think I would make is that, and we spoke about this back in December, the real challenge of inflation is essentially the hidden effect it has on living standards and the power and spending power of government. And that's why even though we've got really fast earnings growth in cash terms, that's being offset by the really high in inflation that we've got there. And that's why we think that living standards will fall this year on the back of falling last year. And that then is feeding through to government. So even though government is spending more money and increasing government expenditure quite substantially, that's being offset by the high effects of inflation. And that's why tackling inflation is so important and getting it back down to a more comparable level, so you're not essentially in this constant cycle of erosion of the actual spending power in there. And then in the Scottish context, what does that means in terms of eroding the things like borrowing powers, the effectiveness of the borrowing powers? And if it all works out correctly and we get inflation back down, then you can start to get back onto a more normal path where more standard earnings growth can actually lead to improvements in living standard because it's growing ahead of inflation. We still expect that will happen. So we think that disposable incomes will start to increase next year. It will take a while to come back to where they were pre-energy crisis levels, and the same for government expenditure as well, that government expenditure will start to rise again in real terms. But clearly, government, within that overall envelope, has got really big pressures around rising pay costs and cost of delivery of services as well.
Yeah, just on the earnings, we had a discussion earlier on about comparative rates in Scotland projected with the rest of the UK. It'd be useful to know if there's any comparison with Scotland with the rest of the UK, excluding London. And also, there was no mention at all, which I was kind of surprised at, or maybe I'm just getting this wrong, of comparatively positive performance in Scotland in terms of employment itself, whether it's employment, unemployment, or even now, for the first time, I think, economic inactivity, all of which have been well ahead of the UK for a number of months. That would surely have an impact on your... Is that part of your calculations, in fact?
Yeah. A couple of things. You're right. So the comparison between Scotland and the UK, one of the slightly unfortunate things in the nature of the fiscal framework means that the focus is always on Scotland versus the rest of the UK. And actually, when you start to unpick that and you take out London and the South East, you get quite different stories about how Scotland is doing from an economic perspective compared to other parts of the UK. And we know from all the data that Scotland outside London and the South East typically comes in next in terms of rankings and most economic indicators. That being said, the nature of the fiscal framework means that what matters and what we're signed up to is that relative performance in Scotland and the rest of the UK, including London and the South East. So that's why we focus on that so much. And that's why it matters for earnings. On the point about the labour market and employment levels and inactivity rates, one of the things that we have seen in recent years, and this is over the longer term, so this is just the most recent stuff, is that there has been a decline in participation between Scotland, challenging participation between Scotland and the UK, and some of that is demographics. But there's something which we have quite a big discussion in the report this time, where we look at changes in inactivity and the difference in data that we're getting in terms of levels of activity between Scotland and the UK. And one of the things that we're not sure of yet, and we just need some more data to see it a bit more, is that while both Scotland and the UK have got declining participation because of age, Scotland hasn't kept up with the UK in terms of participation amongst the key age bands, so particularly in the middle of the demographics. Now, we don't really know why that's the case. It might be a data issue. It might be issues tied to the North East, etc. And the loss of jobs there since 2014. But that's something which I think we want to really keep an eye on, just that differences in participation in the midpoint in there. So we have quite a bit of discussion in there, and we talk a bit about some of the data in there, which basically concludes that we're not sure yet.
Can just ask if you've got any data on FDI compared to the rest of the UK, excluding London, just Scotland's relative performance. But also, and this betrays the fact I've not been involved in these discussions previously, but the discussion which we've had around the reconciliation of 700 million, just to try and get my head around it, is what you said earlier on, basically saying this is down to a timing and forecasting situation. It's not due to, as best I can tell, and tell me if I'm wrong, any decision of the Scottish Government or any financial act of the Scottish Government. Obviously, that will follow on from the forecasting, but initially it's a forecasting situation. And just to say that the idea of any consistency in when you can do your forecast seems undermined by budgets changing every year or not taking place when expected. It's not like it used to be in the 80s and 90s and even in the zeros where you knew when the budget or the autumn statement was going to happen. It's all over the place for the last few years. But it'd be interesting to know if that adjustment, that £700 million, to what extent is the Scottish Government responsible for that?
A couple on FDIs, you mean foreign direct investment? Yeah, so we track things like data on foreign direct investment and investment levels on that. And there's, broadly speaking, there's two sources. So the government published data on business investment, etc., and we track that, which has actually done quite well over the last year in Scotland. So we track that, and that gives us a broad sense about how the economy is doing. There are also more unofficial estimates that we get, so EY's attractiveness survey, etc., and that gives us an idea about, again, how Scotland's comparing relative to the rest of the UK, and that all goes into the mix when we make an adjustment, when we make our assumptions about the forecast and go in there. So if, for example, we saw lots of data showing significant investment in Scotland and high earnings growth and lots of jobs being created, then that would be something that would be factored into our forecast. They're probably the two main sources that we would use, and that is something which enters into it. In terms of the reconciliation, a couple of things just to mention. So this is reconciliation for 21-2022, and our latest estimate is that we think the net tax position for that year will be negative. So the block grant adjustment will run ahead of where the income tax receipts were. The reason for the big reconciliation is down to differences in forecasts. So that's not about how the economy is performed, at the time. It's just about what the assessment was made back in, I think it was it December 2020 for the OBR or November 2020 for the OBR, and then Scottish Fiscal Commission in January 2021 or early in the spring. And if you remember back to that point during COVID, so the Christmas period, in the run-up to the Christmas period was when the new variant was coming out. There was real concerns about the outlook for the economy, and it was really quite uncertain and negative. Jump forward to when the Fiscal Commission were making their forecasts in the early spring. It was when the vaccines had come out. There was at least a time pass getting through this, so the overall outlook was much more positive. And it's that difference between it. I think we've got a table on page 11, which looks at that. And if you see when the BGA was set in the budget setting process, it was saying that the block grant adjustment would be 11.8 billion. The latest forecast is that's 13.6 billion. Whereas when the Fiscal Commission was making its forecast on income tax, it was 12.2 billion. And now the latest position is 13.4 billion. So the income tax has gone up by a billion, but the block grant adjustment has gone up by 1.8 billion. And it's the difference between the two that leads to the reconciliation. And you can see that in terms of economic performance, they both have gone up, but it's because of the timing of the BGA was in a much more pessimistic period. It's gone up by even more, and that leads to the reconciliation. Yeah.
And just to reiterate a bit point of before, though obviously the timing of the two forecasts was a factor in that case, I don't think we should think of that scale of reconciliation as being something that as a one-off that we won't see again. I think that's something that we should consider that as the sort of scale that we will, we would expect to see. So yes, although there were some rather special circumstances around that number, I think just growing budgets mean that that's the sort of the ballpark we should be thinking of.
Thank you.
Okay. And Ross Greer.
Thanks, Camille. I've got a couple of questions about the calculations around social security spend in figure 5.3, which is on page 81 of your paper. I'd appreciate just a little bit more information. Just on the Scottish Child Payment in particular, obviously part of the theory of that is give families more income, create the stability for the situation for them to then find themselves in a better financial situation where they don't require the child payment. The calculations you've got here show that dip over the next couple of years, but that then slowing down somewhat over the last couple in the cycle. Could you explain a little bit about that tailing off in the decrease?
So you're talking 5.3?
Yeah.
Yeah. That's largely due to changes we've made in our assumptions around take-up and the difference between eligibility and caseload. And we were essentially assuming a higher take-up early on relative to the end of the forecast period. The data that we have show that take-up is ever so slightly less in the just now than it potentially could have been, but we think that it will essentially accelerate and catch back up, and that's why the gap is bigger just now, but it will ease off toward the end. We also think that the actual number of eligible children is less than we were expecting back in December, so in turn that reduces how much we think will be spent.
How much of that, the reduction in number of eligible children, how much of that is a reduction in overall population versus the relative socioeconomic situation of the children? Because I think over the period the 5-year period for this paper, we're looking at something like a drop in 25,000 yeah. children in the primary school role.
Yeah. So one thing I'd say is this is still very much us seeing the data coming through and making judgments on the back of it. But one of the key dominant features for eligibility is that change in projection for child population, and it's less than what we were thinking it was when we were first making these forecasts.
And on the child disability payment, we'd have expected a significant initial spike as we transition to that, away from quite a relatively hostile DWP system towards a deliberately more generous Social Security Scotland system. But the projections for the child disability payment in the same table continue to rise quite significantly. And I understand why that's the case for adult disability payment, where our adult population is becoming more ill as a result of a number of factors. Is that the same driver behind child disability payment, or is it something else?
It's a mixture of both. So we have seen higher inflows into child disability payment than the previous benefits there. So part of that is us projecting essentially higher demand coming through as into the future, and some of that's linked to the economic situation, and some of that's just linked to the higher demand that we're seeing in terms of children coming forward for and being eligible for these benefits.
Yeah, there's about one third of the increase is down to sort of UK-wide trends, and the other two thirds to the launch of the new payment.
Right, thanks. And on a different note, away from that table, Francis, you mentioned towards the start of the session about the North East over the next couple of years no longer being quite as much of a drag on the Scotland-wide income growth figures. This committee took some evidence, I think it was late last year, on regional differences in income growth, and the really stark difference was east-west, and that's reflected in population figures as well. All the local authorities across the east coast are projected to grow, whereas Argyll and Bute and Inverclyde have got the most significant decrease. How much of that regional data are you able to draw out for the purposes of this projection?
Yeah, so we're looking, so this is one of the useful things we get from this RTI data. We can get regional data and regional incomes. And I think we're very focused on Aberdeen in that area, because what we've seen historically is that's the outlier. I mean, yeah. So Scotland, in fact, Scotland as a whole tends to have rather similar earnings growth, and indeed that earnings growth tends to be rather similar to the rest of the UK, whereas Aberdeen in that area is a variation. So I think that's one thing we've seen is important in understanding, obviously, what's a key part of our forecast, why Scottish earnings diverge, and already in what's interesting in the data that we've seen is that the Aberdeen area, which is for a long period now has had slower earnings growth than the rest of Scotland, on the latest data is up with the average of Scotland. So that's sort of in line with our story that actually that area will no longer be a drag. Although, as Graham rightly pointed out, how long that continues is really hard to judge at this point, because we still think that the North Sea is obviously a mature and declining sector, and therefore that long-run trend is there. But we're just obviously seeing a period now where that where there's a bit of a mini renaissance in that area because of what's been going on in energy prices and the rest.
Is the West potentially going to become that drag? Or are we going to continue to see a gap? Are we going to see the gap continue to grow between earnings in East and West? Because we saw that, some concerns around that coming out. Certainly, I've heard them locally off the back of the Freeport announcement. There's going to be one in the North, one in the East, but not in the West, where we're already seeing, not that I'm in favour of Freeport, so stressed out, but that we're already seeing this issue of not just a fallen population in the West Coast, but a fallen in average income relative to, or fallen average income growth compared to the rest of the country.
So that's been a long, as you mentioned, that's been a long-term trend in Scotland for the last 20, 30 years, is particularly the shift east and the growth of earnings, etc., in the east. And part of that's a sectoral mix, particularly financial services and energy over in the east, which is grown there. I guess what matters now is what happens going forward, because that's all baked into the baseline. So the fact that earnings in the west, for example, are slightly lower than the east, then That's made from the initial adjustment. What matters is what kicks on from there, and that's where that relative performance is really important. As you were asking your question, I've got a really good chart that basically answers your question. So, but it's probably not great for the public record just to show it. but we can write and show you that, and that just shows you the difference between UK and Scotland and the gap that's emerged, but just a crucial bit of Aberdeen and the northeast in there, and that actually helps explain quite a significant chunk of it there. And what matters is going forward from that.
As I brought up the Freeports that occurred to me, have you projected anything on the basis of the expected economic impact of the Freeports? I realise we're very early in that process.
No, I think we'd need clear policy about what that would be, and the question for us is, would have a material macroeconomic impact over the course of the 5-year funding horizon that we look for. We'd need to make a judgment call about whether that would be the case or not, what displacement and deadweight would be associated with it. So,
and final point around the availability of data, and this may be straying outside your remit somewhat, but I'd be interested in your thoughts on it. Obviously, you have access to significant amounts of public data that's not otherwise in the public domain. But if we look at things like some of the independent tax proposals that have been put together, the paper that the STC commissioned, for example, there's quite a significant difference between the additional revenue that they're saying would come from some of their tax proposals versus what's in the ready reckoners. But I'd be interested in your thoughts on whether there is enough information in the public domain to aid a healthy public debate, mm-hmm. because it creates a bit of tension, obviously, where the STC say that, you know, putting 2p on the top rate will raise an additional 200 million, and the ready reckoners say it will be essentially net neutral.
Yeah. A couple of things. I think, again, you'd expect to say the more information that's out there, the better and the more accessible. There are actually really good tax models out there, so Scottish Parliament have access to things they can do, calculations around this. So I think on the basic tax policy choices, that then I think there is capability for people to do that and set it out. So that's the first point. The second point comes down to, I think there's a lot, it comes down to what might be the behavioural changes that go into that. And we have quite rigorous and quite open and transparent marginal tax and behaviours that will come into all of that. And they have material impacts on the end outcomes. So I guess the question is, are there people with other numbers out there, are they doing that? Are they talking about the static effects, or are they talking about dynamic effects? And that's typically where the big differences
are. I think it's worth adding also that, you know, even if you get all the data you ideally want, you also, the other thing you want is a relatively long run of it to actually do economic analysis on. So I think a lot of these questions for Scotland are still relatively open, because we've actually got a rather short run of data to look at. And as I said before, in terms of this behavioural impacts, you know, we are, the Scottish data is really, you know, we're obviously going to do as much as we can with it, but that's why we've historically lent more on the international evidence, where the data is probably the same as Scottish data, but it's just a longer run, and it's been can be analysed in more detail than we can currently do with Scottish data.
We don't use that much private data. One of our general principles is we prefer to use publicly available data because it increases transparency, and there's not a lot of private data floating around in this area, so it is mainly public.
Thanks, Roch. That's all from me, Commissioner.
Thank you very much. Well, can I congratulate both the committee and the witnesses for keeping us to time? And we've done quite well, thank you. Is there anything else you wanted to say that we haven't touched on?
No, just thank you once again for coming along and speaking, and happy to pick up on the long-term work and capital work, et cetera, in future conversations.
OK, well, if I can thank you all for taking part and for your clear answers. Thanks very much. We'll now have a break and we'll start again at 11 o'clock.
Well, welcome back to the second half of our session this morning. We now continue our evidence taking on the Scottish Government's Public Service Reform Programme, and today we are hearing from Claire Burden, the Chief Executive of NHS Ayrshire and Arran. So welcome to the committee. We were meant to be hearing also from Argyll and Bute Integration Joint Board, but they have unfortunately not been able to attend today. So my apologies that you're in the spotlight, but I'm sure we'll get on okay. So welcome to the meeting. We've got about an hour, but we don't have to take all of that time. We'll see how we get on. So I think my first question for you would be, we're looking at public service reform, and initially we thought the government was going to, you know, really have a very clear path for this, and more recently it's been more of a question of, well, each organisation will be looking at reform itself. So can I ask you, do you think that does work, or do we need a stronger steer from the government about the kind of reform they're looking for and where we should be going? Or are you comfortable that for your organisation and similar organisations, you can drive forward reform yourselves?
Thank you. Good morning. As ever, I think there's a mixture to be had here with regards to NHS Ayrshire and Arran. With the unique nature of our population, there are things that I can do within the health and social care arena that perhaps wouldn't be transferable to other parts of Scotland. And so in that way, I think in order to meet the needs of our local people, we do, there are certain things, particularly operational delivery, that it's helpful to have that local flavour and response and responsibility and accountability for designing services that meet the needs of local people. I think the opportunities within digital reform perhaps are where we start touching on the scale of national policy, making it more accessible and making it more equitable. So as a smaller territorial board, our finances are for the 385,000 people within our territory, and there are, that limits our capital capability. So we know that to get the greatest reform, we need to ensure that those digital infrastructures and our infrastructure as a whole is as robust as possible. And that will need some wider national steer. Mm-hmm. And subsidy leverage somehow so that there is equity across all 14 territorial boards. Mm-hmm.
Yes, we had evidence last week about on the IT side that, and it wasn't just health, it was like all sorts of public bodies were kind of fishing in the same pool.
Yes.
For IT experts, and there seems to be a shortage and things. So is that's been your experience, has it?
Absolutely, yes. So we have quite a low baseline currently in NHS Ayrshire and Arran, and we're putting foundations in. We're not seeking whistles and bells. We're wanting an infrastructure that means we can cope with a power surge, cope with the westerlies when we get cut off, and are resilient. And if we are to do that to the best of technology, then you would go to cloud and seek those larger enterprise opportunities. It would be more cost effective to have local servers, but it's not as resilient. So doing the right thing requires digital expertise and maintenance of a system for a wider population, and trying to do that for 385,000 people is just not the same.
Okay. So you've mentioned a couple of times the number of people you have, and if we had Argyll and Bute, I think their number was 85,000, which is even a smaller organisation. But the police made the point last week that, and obviously they are an example of a major reform in recent years, that they went from whatever it was, eight police authorities down to just the one. And I mean, if we were to see that kind of change in the health sector, anything like that, that couldn't be done internally, could it? That would have to be driven by central government.
Absolutely. But There's regional and national networks over and above our territorial board. So the West of Scotland works as a region, and there will be opportunities to optimise what is available. But we would, at the moment, through the 14 territorial boards, our response to digital will be meeting our local needs and working from our local infrastructure. So Glasgow's current position is very different from mine, so I would take disproportionate investment to catch up. So it would be as if I were slowing them down in order for us to catch up. But it's, I think the important bit is scale, and we started with regards to where we were going to get the greatest reform. And I think within digital, that's that one area where national and regional getting us all into that. Into the same ballpark will make a significant difference in terms of public reform. And if we get our digital network right, our ambition is our health and social care partners are aligned to our single patient record. They will have access to the same information. So the digital platforms, it's to get them future-proof.
Yeah. I mean, one of the things we as politicians get from the public is this term postcode lottery, which I personally detest, and which I think really means local decision-making. But there is this balance, is there not, between trying to get a kind of... so that when someone turns up with a broken leg, they get the same treatment in Ayrshire or the Highlands or Glasgow or anywhere else. But on the other hand, your situation, you're dealing with a particular situation. You've got, what, two islands, and Highlands completely different, Glasgow, Edinburgh are completely different as well. How do we get that balance? I mean, the police model has been to go to a much more centralised model in some ways. Does health need to go to a more centralised model?
In our subspecialties, I think there is a need for regional and national models. They're already in place with vascular, cardiac services, so you go to a specialist centre. And I think there are other areas where Scotland could consider working at a regional and national level and building on those, the Jubilee ambitions. I think that it's a definite walk before we can run in that our workforce is territorial at the moment, and my workforce for Ayr is absolutely dedicated to Ayr Hospital. Recruiting to Ayr Hospital is no mean feat, with Crosshouse being that's closer to Glasgow. It's 13 miles. You wouldn't have believed it was so different to recruit to those two hospitals. But the fact remains is that it is, and that comes back to where we started, in that providing local services. When you break your leg, you need an emergency service that's going to fix your leg, and that feels reasonable to have that within a 40-50 mile radius in order that you can get to hospital within the golden hour, wherever that is. The subspecialty, I think, is where we get into the replicating what's happening in vascular and cardiology, in that if it means you travel a little further but you get to see the specialist who can fix you in a shorter period of time just because it's the nature of specialists, there have to be benefits in outcomes with that. And our medical colleagues are in the best place to determine what those zones might be.
Okay, and my next question, my final one, was probably going to be aimed more at the HSCP, but I'll try it with you anyway. I mean, your area, I think, covers, is it three council areas, local authority areas? And I just wondered, you know, is that a problem, or does it not matter, or is it a strength? Because we know that some other health boards, I think Fife, for example, it pretty well matches the local authority area. But is that an issue for you?
Without doubt, it would be easier to have one partner. In just by the realms of there are four of us, and we're each trying to deliver to our local populations. The needs of North, East and South are different, and for such a small area, it's extraordinary how different. So in that way, I think the working through our East councils, our councils know their populations well. They've each develop services around the needs of their local people and the diversity that's offered within those three boards. And I've been very fortunate. I've inherited health and social care partners who are committed to working together. The Caring for Ayrshire strategy isn't new, but I've been here for 18 months. And when the Fire Service, Police Service, along with your councils, talk to the Caring for Ayrshire strategy, I've clearly inherited something that means something to Ayrshire. And that's currently sufficient to bind us together. We have our bumpy sections because we're all wanting to provide the best we can in the here and now. And the nature of emergency and urgency care in this post-pandemic era means that we're not quite as focused on prevention as we would like to be. If in an ideal world we would put so much more into primary and community care because it's the right thing to do, but at the moment the hospitals are spinning like tops and they become the focal points.
Okay, well that opens up, preventive spend opens up a huge area, and the committee spent a lot of time on that, but I'll restrain myself on that and hand over to Michael Mara. Next.
Thanks, Kabila. Hi. You spoke a little bit about IT programmes, and I noticed in the submission that you made that there was a quote in there, the work that you were doing starts us on the journey of delivering the Scottish Government's 2015 Cloud First strategy. Is that correct? Is that the strategy you're working to publish in 2015 and you're starting to deliver it now?
It's since been revised. My understanding is the IT strategy is in the 2022, but the commitments to move to a unified platform and an enterprise model for Scotland, that's what we're aligned to, in order that any of the local platforms that we put in place and the interfaces are compliant with cloud.
Okay, thank you. I suppose reading the submission, I wondered about the scale of the change that's required. I mean, we've talked in this inquiry so far about shift to preventative spend, demographic challenges. Do you think that the programme that you're undertaking is commensurate to the scale of the challenges that you're seeing as a leader in your field around demographics, technology, new forms of healthcare? Is the change that you're representing here, is it up to that task?
I still think it's conservative, but I think it's affordable. So if we were to look to the private sector, you'll be looking at 3% of budgets dedicated to IT, and we are less than 1%. And so, and that's titrated over 3 years. So I think the reform that we've put in place enables us to work with NHS Scotland with some parity with our digital capability. It sorts out our infrastructure in order that it will be compatible with NHS Scotland requirements, but it's also getting our health and social care partners with primary care unified. So 10 million sounds a lot when I'm sitting with year-end 25 million hole. However, it's 3 million, 5 million, 4 million in order to get us where we need to be. And interoperability is where we're going to get our greatest reform. So I think it's...
And if I broaden that out beyond the digital infrastructure to the way that health services are delivered across the whole board, where services are situated, the way you're reforming to or looking at the future of your geography and your people, do you have a change programme that addresses that broader set of issues?
So the software that comes with the upgrades just puts us in a completely different place. So our two acute hospitals, we don't have a bed board. We still manually go round with bed managers finding where people are. We're running three operating systems to run an acute hospital to manage risk, improve safety and reduce avoidable waits throughout the hospital. That one piece of kit that enables people to know where patients are at any one time will change the landscape for emergency medicine and into the body of the hospital. At the moment, the emergency department system isn't attached to the main hospital. It's a standalone system.
Okay. And this I suppose, again, that kind of the broader issue of a rapidly ageing population and how you deal with that. I mean, you think that it's a technological approach you're advocating. Is that what you're saying, to trying to change services rather than talking about where we might address primary care, how you might piece this together? I suppose I'm trying to think of it in a slightly bigger, broader, these driving forces. But you seem to be quite focused on that technology aspect.
So the plan for this year is threefold. We've got to address our bed-based care being the most expensive component in delivery of care, and we talk about bed-based care as if it's just in the hospital, and that's not the case. We've got beds all over the system doing all sorts of things and not necessarily where you want them to go. The second is financial recovery and sustainability, and so we have some very high spend. And then the third is digital, and the digital impacts the other two, in that if we have remote technology, we have mobile technology, but we're tip of the iceberg about what we're capable of doing. And if I can equip a clinician at the patient bedside, wherever that is, in their home, in the community, or in the hospital, if they can all see exactly the same thing, then we will make better decisions on their behalf. And it's the people's independence and keeping them in their own home. If I can equip decision makers with that information, then they're more likely to be able to keep them at home.
Okay. And on the your workforce planning, you said in the submission that you have full-time staff permanently contracted around 9,400. Is that correct?
Yes. Yeah. It waxes and wanes by about 400 from that, but that's...
And there's been a little bit of dubiety, I think, in some of the evidence we've had so far as to what the government's absolute position is on this is in terms of managing the workforce. But the resource spending review, which came out a while back under the previous finance secretary, committed the government to reducing headcount to to pre-pandemic levels. But you seem to be indicating here that your intent is to remove non-FTE permanent staff, so through trying to manage down your bank nurses and other contractors. Am I right as a characterisation? That's what we're
in the first instance. I think until we can get into reform and dramatically change the way a hospital works, our ability to take our headcount down demonstrably and sustainably is limited. Okay. And our vacancy rates are such that we're not I'm robbing a blind space, whereas the there is a reality with that agency and bank spend and the way we choose to work with independent partners.
So you think your ability to meet any broader intent in that regard is limited by the, you say, until we get into reform? So is that a more led process, a more indication perhaps in the direction the convener's talking about? Is it something with more intent from the government? Is that what you're getting into it means?
So this is our ability as a health and social care system to generally get into the primary care are desperate to do more, and they could talk to me or any of us this afternoon should we be able to move money around with a little bit more fluidity. They would be able to offer more support for patients at home in the community, get into that prevention arena, which will reduce demand on the acute setting. And at the moment, I don't have sufficient headroom in able to create that reform. So it feels a year to 18 months of basics, getting our house in order, getting our workforce. I have a really dedicated core workforce as a rural territory. That's not unusual, but I need more in terms of core to get teams to optimal levels of cover. I'm running on minimum. So we've got to focus on that recruitment that will bring down our costs.
But you have consistent budget deficits over the last 6 years, perhaps longer. So prior to the pandemic, what would a headroom that allowed you to invest in that form of shift look like? Is it the elimination of the deficit? Is it a surplus or is it a reduced deficit? And have you had any guidance in that regard?
So it's a reduced deficit. I don't actually have an end point at which time we can turn this round. And I can't underestimate how important it is for us to wrestle with the bed-based care and what those models look like. I'm in a system that is heavily dependent on bed-based care and unscheduled bed-based care being in an acute setting. It doesn't have to be that, and others have been successful. So I think that there are considerable margins for change in NHS Ayrshire and Arran, but at the moment, it doesn't feel as if it's possible. So we've all been in a position where we're face down, where people are generally overfaced by what they see, and I think that's what I'm working with at the moment.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Kavir.
Okay, Liz Smith next.
Thank you. You said something very interesting earlier about the sort of territorial approach of some in the workforce, and I think that would be true of patients and families too, who get very attached to their local hospital medical service, and we've seen what can happen when anybody has any hint of either closing a hospital or shutting down parts of it. Yet, you're quite correct in what you're saying, that for the benefit of medical services in the future, that's exactly what has to happen to make it more efficient. What do you think we have to do to bring the public with us in the nature of that reform? Because I personally think that's going to be a very difficult challenge. Do you have any suggestions about what we do to take the public with us?
It's going to be the medical voice that makes sense of it with regards to... I think the needs of a local hospital, the definition of a district general hospital is that it's there when you need it and it's there 24/7.
Yep.
And the maintenance of life in that period and thinking what pre-hospital care is and those acute things are, that's core to the NHS, and being clear with people. So AIR is a perfect example in that you move anything and people are really worried you're going to shut it. I can't possibly support health provision in NHS Ayrshire and Arran without both hospitals, so I need to find a way to keep them both. However, should I be unfortunate enough to have a brain hemorrhage, actually we need to get you to a neurological centre, because that's where your outcomes are going to be different, just by the nature of specialist care. And I think if people can hear from the medics how we can effectively move patients around Scotland to ensure that they get speedy access to the right surgeon, and that system's designed to say yes, it becomes a different offer.
So what you're effectively saying is that the better decisions and the ones that will be probably more accepted by the public are those that are made by the clinicians, by the medical people themselves, rather than people who are in administration. And I think one of the things that interests me about comments on the COVID era is that because it was so very serious for everybody, the decision-making in hospitals was actually pretty effective because it was made by the clinicians who decided how they had to run the wards. And I think that's quite an interesting lesson about the future, because if we are going to change the whole setup of the health service, I think the clinicians, the medics, are incredibly important in this. And I'd just be interested in your views about how easy it is in modern health services to ensure that it is the medical people rather than the administrators who take the decisions.
So we've just embarked on a change programme called Clinically Led, Managerially Enabled. And it's a little bumpy because it's not an insignificant change for both schools, actually. So putting medics in a position that we've got some really difficult decisions to make. I've got some amazing services at Ayr, and you know, I have difficulty recruiting into critical care, and so we're putting all sorts of contingencies in, but the debate is with the clinical team. I can't magic up staff, but I can build contingencies whilst we seek new staff with the clinical teams. I think that there's also something for management with regards to, I can make your life as a clinician as easy as humanly possible by enabling the things that you don't do. As a manager, you can bash out business cases, you can come and make cases in a political space. We can support them through that space. They don't have to be good at everything, but they're steering what is medically right, will get us the best outcomes for Scotland. It feels the most appropriate and safe place to be.
So it's your recommendation, the actual structure of oversight of the health service needs to change a bit to facilitate that. And does that include, I mean, we were due to hear from other witnesses this morning, does that include the IGB structure? Would you recommend any changes on that front?
So I think we've got we've had some changes in clinical leadership within there as well. And of course, I'm only sitting here for NHS Ayrshire and Arran. And our primary care clinicians and our medical sponsors within those arenas are strong and vibrant. And so I think it mirrors, but clinically led, the NHS says it on the tin, in that we need the steer and guidance. Modern medicine and what that means, and wanting care closer to home. I'm going to be asking something very different of our clinical leaders, in that these helicopter roles, saying, come and be my medical director and look after 385,000 people. And it's not necessarily their first language, but these people do this. I think that it offers a huge opportunity to genuinely think about healthcare provision in a different way. And as a manager logic person, that only goes so far. You need somebody to help us steer where outcomes are generally going to be different.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. And Michelle Thompson's next.
Good morning. Thank you for joining us. We had some interesting evidence last week from somebody who attended from Police Scotland, who made clear that the creation of the body simply wouldn't have occurred had it not been mandated by government. So I wanted to ask you some kind of perception questions in terms of your world. So in Scotland, with what, 5.5 million, we've got 14 territorial boards and 5 national boards, and with duplication of HR directors, IT directors, finance directors. Is the scale of this and that current organisational structure something that you and your equivalents have had discussions about attempting to change? I mean, I know the BMA, for example, have released a report, but is that something that you've kind of looked at and even suggested some change with your kind of face-off equivalents across other boards?
So no, I haven't discussed that as a tack. I think personally, there are things I cannot do because of I lack the scale. Yeah. And I think, you know, I'm a proportional slice of 14, and that makes that does limit reform. Yeah. And I think this comes back to our original questions, that providing a national health service for 5 million people over this footprint is a health economics challenge. And so working with our clinicians, there is a piece of work to be had through health economics about what needs to be done at scale. And I don't think there's an easy question there, and maybe that's not where we've not gone there. But in the 18 months I've been in Scotland, for sure, whenever we've said something, it has been done 4 or 5 years ago. So I should imagine that if you were talking to a CEO with more experience under their belt of Scotland, this piece of work in health and economics will have been done at some stage. Possibly the complexity of the social care agenda with the health agenda and the way Scotland has tackled the integration through IJBs as a vehicle was an option under that initial appraisal.
Yeah. And following on from that, in your opinion, does the fact that individual staff are employed by their kind of local board with potentially different terms and conditions, does that inhibit flexibility of moving staff around because they're employed by different boards or not the same ease of transition? Is that something that you experience trying to attract people into your area?
Expanding that's extraordinary. So across the 14 territorial boards, we can have the same job banded at a different rate. So we have had a great challenge in employing digital practitioners, particularly network practitioners, and estates, head of estates. We're a band lower in NHS Ayrshire and Arran than Glasgow, and being a stone throw away from one another, trying to encourage people to come to a territory to do exactly the same job at a different band. So I'm not sure that the terms I haven't come across that terms and conditions are wildly different. Those are pretty much transferable, but banding is a national challenge.
And given the autonomy of all the different boards, the Centre for Sustainable Delivery was designed to stop NHS boards working as autonomous units. Is it your experience that it does?
Stop us working
autonomously, or
no? I haven't. That's not been my experience.
Okay.
I think at this moment in time when we're doing this post-COVID recovery, and you give yourself a quick pinch in that nobody's done this. Mm-hmm. There's no senior leadership team who have led a recovery from a pandemic, and so we pretty much are learning on our feet because there are specialties that were. Did something completely different to their day job for 3 years, and now we're asking them to go back. And there are other people whose jobs ticked. And when you think that sounds horribly simple, but actually merging these two groups of people back together, having had two very different experiences, and some administrative workforce that actually have been able to work well remotely, but we need to get people working alongside each other. That's the challenge of the moment. So I think for the Centre of Sustainable Services, our discussion has been very much how do we get people back together, hence our clinically led reform, trying to just provide a nucleus, a purpose to bring people back together. Mm. COVID was a single disease management moment in time where we were all focused on one thing. We had to keep the front door running because people still had coronaries, heart attacks and everything else, but it was about wrestling this one disease. We're now back to the plurality that is providing health and social care, and we can't respond in the way that we did for 3 years because of the plurality, because we need the specialists in the room to help us make decisions. And I think the Centre of Sustainability has been working with us. How do we help create that congruence of purpose again?
Mm. And I mean, obviously, I went through your submission and you've mentioned deficit reduction and efficiency in delivery and distributed working. Those questions I asked you earlier variously about staff and corrected me, banding, number of territorial boards, Centre for Sustainable Delivery. Are they precisely the sort of changes you would expect to see mandated by central government in line with the comment we had at the start of this inquiry about Police Scotland? It wouldn't have happened had it not been mandated. Those things I asked you questions about earlier, are they the sort of things you would expect to see mandated, and therefore your primary focus is on those areas you've set out, and both in your evidence here today and in your submission?
So in terms of the delivery plan, there's quite clear steer in the guidance given. I suppose I'm not sure how much more mandated it could be. Our elective recovery, the the what good looks like.
If you were going to change something at significant scale, when I was set out the context with the 14 territorial boards and 5 national boards, kind of restructuring that, Anna mentioned about the Centre for Sustainable Delivery, that kind of scale of change and organisational structure, is that something you'd expect to see mandated from the government rather than being fed upwards from yourself or people you face off with and other boards?
Sorry, I'm trying to pitch the from that mandated lens. There are, from a territorial perspective, the flexibility that we have at the moment is welcome and giving us sufficient to design things locally. I think if there were more of a mandated steer, it would be around the performance outcomes and our concerns from a CE. So you talked to me about, you know, what the CE is discussing. Our concerns are our ability to maintain the service that we have with the future that we've got. So in terms of mandated bits and working with the public, I suppose it's the helping the managing expectations and how do we have these discussions is in that arena of mandated. We're in a different position. We're not the same service that we were 3 years ago. We're very different. And we are learning at pace about how to get ourselves back. So in that, in the outcomes arena, more mandate is an opportunity.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks, Michelle. Keith Brown next.
Thanks very much. You'll be aware that there's both in Scotland and the UK COVID inquiries which will be looking at various things, including the shortcomings of mainly politicians and others. But just from hearing you speak, it's worth just saying that it's an absolutely fantastic achievement to get through COVID, keeping the services running at the same time. Hopefully in due course people will recognise the scale of that achievement. I wonder though, going back to Michael Mara's points, on the bit about supplementary staffing approaches, and you've said you intend to reduce by half this year. Now, I know we're only 2.5 months or it is 3 months into it, but have you got any idea of how things are going so far?
So they're going well, actually. A considerable amount of work has gone into the last year to understand our dependence on agency and bank staff. A lot of work was done to encourage staff to consider their core hours in contracts. So as we approached the celebration period and a new year, we gave open anybody on reduced contracts. Would they take on, even for short-term, additional hours? We had people who very kindly did that. We've expanded our bank. And in the last 4 weeks, our agency ask is 20%+ lower, so a very positive start. You'll be aware, as a committee, that we were challenged to reduce our agency spend and a break glass ceiling, a cap on outer framework agency staff was put in place. We're literally 7 days into that. I think people were expecting a bit of a mushroom from the NHS, and that hasn't happened. I think there are areas across Scotland that have had to have a break glass for a subspecialist to get cover. But I'm pleased to share that we haven't had to break glass in the last seven days. But as you say, it's a really early phase in the year, and if there is ever a steady state in the NHS, it is this 16-week period between the summer and spring. But we have reduced our bed base by 60 beds. We've reduced our delayed discharges, not to where we want to be, but it's at least 50 lower than it was at the beginning of the year. So those important metrics that make a difference to core services have started to embed.
Thanks for that. On the issues about staffing, which you've mentioned, and perhaps the additional problems there are for significantly rural health boards, a long, long time ago, I was in the military, and if you trained to do something specific that was quite expensive, they would keep you in the military. They also told you where you were going to serve. I just wondered whether in the NHS, whether it's GPs or other services, if some more, we're talking about local and national control or thing, if there's some more control over that, so you graduate from medical school and for at least a period afterwards you're obliged to go, perhaps where there are shortages of GPs or whatever else, would you see a role for that, or would that just not fit within the health service currently?
I'm not sure that it would encourage us to do to in that retention piece if people were directed to where they needed to be. I think that there are. I'd like to think that keeping people in the country is an incentive in that. Our medics work hard. Our medics and nurses, all our professionals, allied health professionals. If you've gone through that training and supportive training, if there were a way of retaining them in Scotland with good job opportunities, giving them access to technologies and so forth, new practice research, I think that would be more of an incentive for our workforce to stay with us than mandating where they needed to work. So just thinking, our medical director 3 years ago introduced a new medical workforce where clinical fellows were injected at pace, and they went from 20 clinical fellows, we have 120 now, and so incentivizing colleagues to work and in teams that are of a decent size, which means that you've got opportunity to be the medic, nurse, practitioner that you train to be. I think that's a most attractive way of keeping people.
Yeah, just to recognise the pressures you're talking about, I live also in an area which has got three local authorities, has only one general hospital as of around 15 years ago, although probably not as big a land area as the Ayrshires. I just wonder, in the areas where you said previously that you thought, I don't want to put words in your mouth, but essentially a more national role might be beneficial. And I know it's a difficult question to ask, but to what extent do you think health boards, as currently constructed, help or hinder towards doing that, where it might be more appropriate and beneficial for the service?
I think it would be fair to say we're parochial. It's by the nature of we're trying to make sustainable our own territorial boards. We're softly competing with people for staff, kits. So I think that the way we're set up, we're each out for survival of our own. So I don't think it's the easiest thing to do. However, as a group of CEs, the most important thing is sustainability for NHS Scotland, and we have significant conurbations with major hospitals, and we have district general hospitals that have managed to get exceptional specialty in. So I'd do a quick shout out for our urology service and our orthopaedic service. I'm going to miss somebody, and that's going to be bad. But there are services within rural boards that have managed to collect exceptional people that have created special teams around them, and I think that if there were opportunities to expand on that and offer regional and national services, I believe that every territorial board would have an exceptional person. And I suppose that would be my only other share. We talk regularly about what can we replicate, what is the good practice that we can replicate, and there's a lot of effort that goes into that, but there are services and opportunities that emerge because you have somebody exceptional leading them. And I suppose perhaps that's the mushroom we should be looking for, in that when we land up with these exceptional people that attract exceptional people and create something different, rather than just trying to replicate it, how do we grow it in that place for the benefit of more people?
Thank you, and thank you to all your staff as well for the work over recent years.
That's very kind, thank you.
Okay, thanks Keith. Ross Scrier.
Thanks, Convener. Apologies if I missed this in your answer to Michael Maher's questions around digital enhancement, but are you able to quantify the financial savings from some of those upgrades? So, for example, that the bed management patient tracking system that you were talking about, do you know how much, not that it's all about the money, obviously, but do you know how much money you would expect to save from that kind of upgrade?
The return on investment piece with digital? No, I don't have it. I don't have it in a trajectory, but I will get it in a trajectory within the year. So what I have struggled with is being able to translate the... So I mentioned the independent sector with 3% of budgets going to it would be normal. Ours is less than 1%. You would expect that digital reform could return anything up to 11% in terms of internal efficiency. But I need to find something that meets all the requirements of finance in order to get that into my cost avoidance. I can share with you that a ward round in our current combined assessment unit takes 3 hours because they have to go through the red file, the yellow file, and the three digital systems and look up labs and get into the PAC system. So it takes 4 hours. That should be a board and ward round that clinicians can get round a board and do in less than an hour. So if I could save that amount of time for a clinical team just by board rounding, then that is genuinely time put back in with patients. So I will. It's not in the budget because there isn't a piece of reform that I can lift and shift with any validity into a finance spreadsheet. But I have challenged the system. We've got to do that because we need to be able to demonstrate £10 million against our budget over 3 years isn't significant, but it's significant when I'm not doing other things. So yeah. I've got a critical care unit that needs work. I've got a day case unit that needs expanding. We are sacrificing things to get the digital systems right in order that we can make change. So I need to demonstrate for people what that is giving back to the system.
Thanks very much. And it's been mentioned already that the board's been running a deficit for, I think, since 2017, but there was quite a lot of progress made in closing that deficit between 2017 and the start of the pandemic when everything kind of went out the window in that regard somewhat. Would you be able to tell us about how you managed that year-on-year reduction in the deficit over that, I think it was the three-year period before pandemic financial years?
So that was pre-me, my predecessor. There was, when this was in 2017, where the deficit went to 20 million, and they brought in a financial director, a service improvement director, who systematically worked with operations to reduce the bed base. And reducing the bed base within the acute sector year on year resulted in a baseline improvement across a wide spectrum of measures. Obviously, it's not just the workforce, the bed space, but all the other logistics that go alongside those reductions. And over a 24-month period, the bed base reductions were... I think the deficit got down to 14 million. Just before the pandemic, but it was a systematic process of reducing beds in the acute sector.
Thanks. And just finally, your paper mentions there's been opportunities for collaboration, particularly with local authorities when it comes to property, your estates. I'm wondering again if you could give us any examples on where that collaboration has worked well to increase efficiency.
So possibly the two areas, delayed discharges and that the shared working space both within the hospital and within the community hospitals. So rehabilitation, our stroke pathways were put into a community hospital, and so just sharing that facility in order to reposition rehabilitation services. We had the cancer unit that was moved to the Kyle. So our cancer units were in the acute setting, and we took them took the non-critical patients into a community setting and developed a unit within the within the community. That was a height of the pandemic thing that people were quite worried about, and now we're the patients prefer that to the acute setting, not least that if you're poorly with cancer, if you can pick up to a community unit and walk in, as opposed to pitching up at the front door of an emergency department and having to walk past everybody when you're feeling a little grim, that was significant. I suppose the other piece is the distributed working piece, where we've shared office space and you can book desks anywhere in the system. We're the zero desk policy is still new, and once going back, it's a little bit bumpy as we navigate our way through that. But it does mean that we can look to centralise where we need accommodation and not.
Thanks very much. That's all from me, Convener.
Thanks, Ross. Doug Slimson.
And hi, Claire. I was just going to ask about shared services. Obviously, we've got multiple health boards, we've got 32 local authorities, IJBs as well, which will mean each one of those with their own finance director, HR director, and IT director. Do you think there's any scope within the public sector landscape just now to try and reduce some of those roles and trying to consolidate into a more of a shared service model?
Yes. and as ever, it's not simple, is it? In that these are well established structures now. My understanding for NHS Ayrshire and Arran is that there was a piece of work in 2016-17 where they were close to unifying into a single IJB, so North East and South collaborating, and over a period of months it was all but there, and the infamous COVID came along, and here we are. I think the backdrop of the care service, National Care Service, is a bit of a distraction in that. We are in the process of renewing our partnership agreements, going back to those. It's the 5-year review of those partnership agreements, and at the moment, that is still within those three councils. Mm-hmm. And there has been no discussion to go back to what was achieved in 2017. I haven't heard that there's an appetite for it.
So do you think organisations can do that change voluntarily, or is it back to the point I think Michelle made, it has to be mandated from the centre before you get real reform amongst these organisations?
I think that would take a mandated change. I think that the structures are in, and it would be quite difficult. That would be along with myself thinking that actually a West of Scotland board and taking out a health board would be the right thing to do. And I've got 13 other colleagues who might completely disagree with me that a health board with a population of a million would have a slightly different landscape to navigate than four or five of us covering the same landscape.
Mm-hmm. And you mentioned prevention earlier, and you seem to suggest that you would like to do more on that, but you don't have the resource, whether that's people or cash, basically, to make that switch.
Yep.
So how do we break that cycle? Because we hear from government ministers as well that prevention and early intervention is key, and that's how we'll get savings later on. But I don't see the a firm change onto that to the prevention sort of model instead.
So I need to reduce the spend in the acute sector in order that we can reinvest in the community. There's still rafts of work that is referred to the secondary and tertiary services for advice, and we're following traditional models, the outpatients, and you're added to the list and you get there. And I have teams of people desperately trying to work through those. And when you talk to primary care and community, what they want is a discussion or a test or access to something. If it were that simple, of course, we'd have done it. Mm-hmm. So the transformation wheel that we have at the moment is that we understand that we're cash-strapped, which means that we have got to get to the stage where we can lead through our clinicians. So primary care have said they want to do more in the prevention arena, and I'm very fortunate I have very strong, positive primary care, both in and out of hours, and they will help us scope what they need in order to do more. There are already programs in diabetes and respiratory that are run perfectly well with a community-led bias, mm-hmm. and we need to lean on those again, and it's safety and opportunities, and also working with our medical colleagues who have chosen secondary and tertiary care, that this isn't taking activity away from them. This is wanting to give them more time for the people who generally mm-hmm. need to get in their arena, and that will be made so much more possible if we have the voice of the clinicians in the middle of it, in that we are short of medics, we're short of nurses, so there is plenty of work for everybody. I've got a 5-year order book for acute. This isn't, please don't worry about your jobs. What I'm desperate to do is get you in, get the right patient in front of you in order that you can be the best person that you can be.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And you mentioned earlier 60 beds being removed. And you're looking to reduce the supplemental staff and support by half. So that's my calculations, 475 FTE equivalents. How do you do that without impacting patient care, especially when we're looking at things like waiting times, increasing?
I don't think it's quite that many staff, but just because of average salaries. But at the moment, when the roll forward was created, we had 185 additional beds in the acute system, and that cost us £13.5 million last year just for additionality. So that additionality has made everything else slower. So our average length of stay is longer in Ayrshire than many other parts of Scotland because we're spread too thinly. If we can reduce our average length of stay to the average for Scotland, I have no additional beds. We immediately have £13.5 million against our deficit. If we were to get to the upper quartile, then I have two empty wards. Two empty wards, that's three million mm-hmm. to be able to, what can we do differently, and or flex for winter. When you're looking down the system at the moment, and I'm very careful where you have these discussions, because for people who are living in the melee, that is COVID recovery, when we've got suboptimal staff and not enough people to go around, you sound like a lunatic. Because, of course, we've got ambulances queuing outside, so the currency is beds. The currency is not beds. The currency is workforce and decision makers, and that generally makes us efficient. So I appreciate the numbers feel really high, mm-hmm. and talking to averages doesn't ring with confidence. But there at the heart of running a hospital is a ward round, and a ward needs teams. And I think you would be hard pressed to find a fully resourced team in any part of my service.
Mm-hmm. So you mentioned the length of stay, which is obviously quite key. You want to get people in and out as quickly as possible. Why is it so high in your board just now, and how are you going to change that?
So it's high, one, because of the additional beds, and my core works, you've seen that the workforce has gone up, but they're not all on the wards. So I'm running with minimum staffing levels, and minimum staffing levels means that I'm not making optimal decisions every day for every patient, because there are 185 people in the wrong place. At its peak, we had 200 delayed discharges, so circa 15 to 20% of the bed base were people waiting to go home. Mm-hmm. These are all things that you can go at. The average wait for a patient in my three health and social care partners varies from 3 days to 2 weeks in terms of response. And it's not, it's nobody's fault. The operating models are are different. South relied had a model that was heavily dependent on the private sector. The private sector has withdrawn from home care, and particularly rural home care. That's a very difficult thing to pull off in a private enterprise. So I think there is absolutely scope within what we've got to do more and different. But I have 10,000 people to convince that it's within their gift. Mm-hmm. And when you're working at 110%, it's quite difficult to sound sensible.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
But that's the job.
Good. Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Right, well, thanks, Committee, and thanks very much, Ms Burden. You've been very, I think, frank and open, and I think it's been beneficial that maybe you've not been in your job for such a long time, and you've given us a kind of fresh approach and been prepared to be honest with us. So, very grateful for your input this morning. Was there anything else you wanted to say that we haven't touched on?
No, thank you very much.
Okay, right, well, thank you. And we'll now... That concludes the public part of today's meeting. The next item on our agenda, which will be discussed in private, is consideration of our work programme. So we now move into a private session.